Hello, and welcome to our Tacoma Astronomical Society online videos. My name is Alice View, and I am a volunteer with the Tacoma Astronomical Society. And this video covers astronomy online tools, specifically Stellarium, the web version. Key features we will cover: setting your location, setting and manipulating time, searching for specific topics, and planning a viewing session. So let's go ahead and get started with Stellarium, the web version. When you first get into the Stellarium website for Stellarium Web, it will probably look something like this when it first pops up. On the far left-hand side, you have a chance to set up viewing settings, and they're not very many settings at all. When you open it up, you can tell it to turn on and off the Milky Way, on and off deep sky objects, and to simulate refraction. So that is compensating for the amount of atmosphere that you have between you and the stars. You can add the meridian, which is an imaginary line that runs directly over your head as the viewer from north to south. And turn that on and off. And you can also turn on and off the ecliptic, and that is also a line that runs across our sky, and it is the path that we see the sun and the moon and our planets kind of hovering around that band in which the ecliptic goes through. So those are some of the things that you can set up in Stellarium Web. There's another feature called Planets Tonight, and if you click that feature, it's going to pop up a little bar. And on that bar, it's going to show you the sun, the moon, and then those naked eye visible planets and when you can see them. So we're going to talk about this when we talk about time, but this blue bar is daylight hours. So we're looking at here from noon as we go into twilight, civil twilight, and then this kind of bluish gray area, and then the gray area is astronomical twilight, and then when it turns to black, that should be full dark. So then you have everything going from full dark at evening twilight through midnight, and then you reverse the process. And as we start getting closer and closer to dawn, you'll see the colors transition as we go from astronomical twilight back to civil twilight and sunrise. So any of these yellow bands in the dark area represent planets or the moon that we can see once the sun sets. And some of those that sit very, very close to the horizon, often Mercury and Venus, show up because they're very close to the sun. So they tend to be kind of hovering around those daylight areas. Bands that do not show during the black band are only visible or only up during your daylight hours. All right, so we'll close that. So those are the two things that you can do on this bar. And then by tapping the three lines, which is very similar to three dots, you can put that away. And then it leaves you with the entire screen altogether for Stellarium Web. So let's talk about setting our location. So in the lower left-hand corner, you're going to see its guess on where you are. If you are on Wi-Fi, it will try and pick up your location from there. And when you first bring it up, it does that. It does go to auto-locate. So if you don't want it to try and guess where you are and you want to force it to go someplace else, you can always just unclick the auto-locate. And it just shows you a map at this point, and you can zoom out on the map, and I could just pick this up and click it over and move it over to where I want to observe. So let's say, for example, let's go to Enumclaw. Let's go observe over in Enumclaw, Washington. And so we've just adjusted that, and then we could use that location. And so if we do that, if you look down again at the lower left hand, you'll see Enumclaw. The other thing that you can do is up here is the search key, and if you hover over the magnifying glass, you'll get the search bar. So then you can start typing in the name of the city that you want to go to. All right, and then once you do that, hit enter, and it will search. And I find using the down arrow button is easier than using the mouse. The mouse sometimes loses that whole search altogether. So I have found Tacoma, so we'll switch back over to Tacoma, and it's going to put me in the city center in that case. All right, so we'll go ahead and say use this location, and we're back again in Tacoma. All right, so that takes care of setting a location. So setting the time, so in the lower right hand corner, you have a time bar. So this time bar looks very much like the time bar that we just saw for our find the planets and knowing what planets were up and available. As far as controls, there is a play and a pause. So I can pause time right now, and then I can hit the triangle again. That looks just like the same type of controls you have on your remote from your television. And so let's just pause that again. The other thing I can do is this clock right here that has the clock face and backwards in time is actually, if I click that, it's going to reveal the real time. So the real date and the real time for your viewing session based on the information on your computer. And then I can pause again. So to change the time and to manipulate the dates, if I wanted to go backwards in time, for example, if I want to go back a couple of days and look at something I maybe saw a few days ago when I was outside, I can just tick the down arrow on the days and it will flip through. And so that's one way to manipulate time that way. If I decide that I want to move forward in time so I can get to when it's dark, I can start ticking forward in time and creeping along. Another thing that I can do is down here in our, you know, noon to twilight to nighttime to midnight to sunrise back to noon bar, I have kind of a button. And the button, as I tick forward in time, moves to match that time. I can also grab that button and drag it and drop it to the time that I want. So I could put myself just there in time. I can leave the time the same and decide that I want to go back to where I was in a date, and it just kind of marches the date through. So let's get ourselves a little bit darker here. All right, so here we go. And then again, play and pause. So we're going to leave it on pause because I want time to stand still. All right, so that's how we manipulate time in the program. And as soon as you touch any other part of the screen, it goes back and settles down into that right-hand corner. All right, so let's take a look at what we can do with Stellarium Web. So if I see an object in the sky, like this bright object there, I can click on it, and it will give me information about that object. So I happen to click on Capella, and Capella is a very, very bright, bright star, and it's in the constellation Auriga the Charioteer. So if I look over here to the left of that, it's going to tell me a little bit about the star. It's going to tell me how far away it is. So it's 42.8 light years away. And so if you happen to be almost 43 years old, the day you were born, light left the surface of Capella and started streaming towards Earth, and it is just now arriving. So that's one way to think about distance in as far as how fast light moves. The other thing that you'll find is it will start to do some descriptions about Capella. It will talk about the constellation that happens to be in. It will tell you a little bit more about it. And then it will give you a link to Wikipedia. And so if you click on that link, it will pop up and take you directly to the article in Wikipedia about that object. So there's the article on Capella. All right, so that's what happens if we just point to an object in the night sky. But if I want to go searching for an object in the sky, I can use the search box up here, the search bar. So I am going to go search for Polaris. So as I start to type, it will start making recommendations for objects that it has in its database that match what you're typing so far. Okay, and so it's looking right here at Polaris the star, and that's where I want to go. So I'm going to click on Polaris the star. All right, and so again, it takes me to the star, it highlights the star, and then it's going to bring up the information box on the left-hand side. And so here it's going to tell me when I can see it. It's always visible because it never rises and it never sets at our latitude. And then again, any other information I want. So remember how we looked at Capella, and that was like close to 48 light years away? We're looking at Polaris, and Polaris is 432 light years away. So we don't have anyone listening to this that has a birthday star that is Polaris. All right. So another thing that it's showing us is the name of the star as it relates to its constellation. It's in Ursa Minor, and it is the alpha star in Ursa Minor. So let's take a look at those constellations while we're here. So I'm going to use the Xbox to get rid of the information on Polaris. And then I'm going to turn down here at the bottom, the buttons that we have available to us across the bottom of Stellarium include the constellation lines. So we can turn those on. And so there's Polaris and there's Ursa Minor, the baby bear. And then it also has the constellation art. So it's using the same traditional constellation art as Stellarium, the downloaded version, does. So we'll turn those two off. The other thing that we can do is turn off the atmosphere. So what this is going to do is reduce the amount of sunlight still bouncing around in all of the air and water that makes up our atmosphere. So if we turn that off, we're going to clear that out. And some interesting things happen when you get rid of the atmosphere. Is you start picking up much, much fainter stars, and in this case we're picking up a band of our own Milky Way galaxy. You can turn off the landscape if you want to look at stuff that's kind of below you and has not yet risen. I find it difficult to learn how to find things without a landscape, so I like having that horizon there. All right, we can also turn on a couple of different grids. We'll talk about that in a different video. And we can find and look for deep sky objects. In this case, for example, we just turned on the deep sky objects. Let me pull in a little bit and tilt up. And you'll notice that little blue oval popped up. So what that's doing is it's highlighting that there's a deep sky object there. And so if we were to click on that, it's going to show us that that is M31, also known as the Andromeda Galaxy. And so it brings up the information over here, and it also has a link to a Wikipedia site for the Andromeda Galaxy. Okay. So we're going to turn those off for a minute. The night sky mode allows you to do this outside, and it turns everything red so that you have bright lights not bothering you while you're at the binoculars or telescope or just viewing in the sky. All right, so let's talk a little bit more about moving around. Zooming in and out is done either by using the wheel on your mouse, or if you have a touchpad, it is a two-finger slide together up to push away and down to pull towards you. So I can kind of zoom into things this way. To move left or right, I just click and drag and move around. Now here's a good example where sometimes it is nice to turn off the landscape. I can't control the landscape in Stellarium Web, but I can turn it off because I want to see Venus. Because another thing that we can do as far as zooming in and out, and I don't want the Pleiades yet, I want Venus. And sometimes when things are so close together, like Venus and the Pleiades are right now, she's actually passing through them, it's hard to get the right object. So the search bar will help with that. So you'll notice at the bottom of the information for Venus, you'll see a plus and a minus sign. So we can use this plus sign to zoom in on Venus. And there we have the planet Venus, and since it is orbiting the Sun, but orbits closer to the Sun than we are, so it's on the inside track, we see Venus in phases. And so if you were able to look at a telescope tonight, you would be able to see Venus looking pretty much like that. Okay, so then we can zoom back out again. We can see there that she's in this little beautiful asterism of the Pleiades. And then we'll move back out to where we were before. I'm going to turn the landscape on so I don't get confused and I know how to go outside and look for her. Okay. All right, so that's how we move around. And then let's, so we got a nice view of everything around us here. Come all the way back to the north. I'm going to turn on my constellation lines again because I want to be able to see Polaris and Ursa Minor. So I'm going to zoom out just a bit because we don't have the fast forward type key like we do in the downloaded version. But if I wanted to have time move much more quickly so that you guys could see the entire path of all of our circumpolar stars. So these stars here, Ursa Major, Ursa Minor, Draco, Camelopardalis the giraffe, and Cepheus and Cassiopeia, they don't set at our latitude. So I am going to turn off the atmosphere so the sun can rise and set and we won't notice it. But the other thing I can do is, again, if I capture the bubble here that shows me my time, I can slide it forwards and we can see time moving rapidly and a little bit more slowly. But then you end up getting to noon and then you need to jump forward to get over noon to get the button back to the left side. It's a little odd. But it works. All right, so we've just moved forward a day. Okay. All right, so let's talk about a planning a viewing session using Stellarium Web. So, for example, if I wanted to pick a particular object or objects, then I could use my search bar to figure out where they are in the night sky and then move to them at that point. So if I want to do that, let's say, for example, I happen to know that Jupiter, Saturn, and Mars are all really close together right now, and everyone's talking about how pretty they are in the morning sky. So let's look for Jupiter. So we've got Jupiter, the planet. And from where we are right now, it's still below the horizon, but not that far below the horizon. And I'm going to turn on the atmosphere back again, just so that it's there, and then let's go ahead and grab time and let's slide it forward until we see what we want to see. So there's Jupiter and there's Mars and there's Saturn. All right, so we're looking at about 5 o'clock in the morning and we're starting to see some of the sunlight. In fact, if we keep going, we know just about how much time before the sun really starts to interfere. So right now, Saturn's kind of winked its way out. There's enough sunlight scattering around in the atmosphere now in this pre-dawn sky to get rid of Saturn. So if I want to see all of them, I'm going to need to get up just a little bit earlier. So now Saturn's popped back in again. So here is Jupiter, and there is Saturn and Mars. Let me just click on Saturn. I can't get to Saturn around Mars. So we'll search for it like we did before to help us locate it right there. And let's zoom in and take a look at Saturn. So there is Saturn and its rings. We often will get to see Titan when we're looking at Saturn. We don't see, Saturn's got lots and lots of moons, but they're all very, very faint. And some of them reside within her disk, in her rings. But Titan is bright enough and reflects enough light due to its atmosphere that it is something that we can see in binoculars and a telescope. All right, so then let's go all the way back out again. And there we have Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn. So that's how you use Stellarium Web. That's how you control the time and fix your location, find objects, and plan a viewing night. So I hope you've enjoyed this video and look for more on Tacoma Astronomical Society online.